Good afternoon, Baltimore. Anything is possible. Serving Baltimore City is the only thing I've ever wanted to do with my life. And for the past 13 years, that's what I've had the distinct honor and privilege to do. Our campaign, not my campaign, our campaign for mayor was about building, was about building a new way forward for our city. Recognized that Baltimore could not continue down the path that we were on. We had to realize that we needed to address gun violence and overdose deaths in Baltimore as a public health issue, addressing it from top to bottom and understanding that treating symptoms was not enough, that we needed to build a city government that people can believe in, that the Baltimoreans would know each and every day was working on their behalf, where people in Baltimore, no matter where they live, could thrive. A city government that's not broken, that's not ripe for corruption, and that's not outdated and based in 19th and 20th century. That we could build a city government that invests in the promise of our young people, not simply in their failures. Our campaign was about showing that we could bring people together around a shared vision for Baltimore. One where we're not afraid to talk about Baltimore's horrific past of racial inequality and dare to say that we can erase it. That's what our campaign has been about. Our campaign was about proving to the world that a young black man who grew up in the forgotten Baltimore here in Park Heights could survive everything that you have to live through in Baltimore. The gun violence, underfunded schools, living in neighborhoods with vacant homes, living in areas where you know that you are not going to be recognized even as human by your own city government, that somebody could survive all of that to be the leader of this city, this great city, and serve as an example for the generation. A 23-year-old, wide-eyed college graduate in the city that I've had my entire life. Today, I stand before you, the Democratic nominee for the office of mayor in Baltimore City, amid record turnout, even though every voter in Baltimore had to overcome circumstances that we have never seen, an election we have never seen because of COVID-19. That's where we are today. From the bottom of my heart, I want to thank every single person who voted for me, every person who knocked on the door, before COVID-19, of course, everyone who made a phone call, who did a tweet, who donated a dollar, who just simply said that they believed that Baltimore needed a new way forward. From the bottom of my heart, I truly, truly love and appreciate each and every one of you, and I will never forget it. Your support means more to me than you can ever imagine. To my family, my parents, my grandparents, all my family members who are no longer here, I want to say thank you. I couldn't have not done it without you. You put me in this place by working, moving here from the rural South, escaping poverty, escaping the Jim Crow South, to come here to Baltimore City to provide an opportunity for my generation to live in an area and live in a place where we can actually thrive. And we know that running for mayor and being elected does not come without sacrifices. And nobody has made more sacrifices than the people that you see standing with me today. To Mayor Dixon, I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you for running a clean race about the future of Baltimore City. Thank you for showing people that Baltimore does believe in second chances. And thank you for remaining committed to the city of Baltimore for your entire service and your entire life in the city of Baltimore. To Ms. Miller, to Tharoo Vignaraja, to T.J. Smith, to Stokey Carmichael, to my good friend, all of my good friends, I want to say thank you. Thank you all for dedicating yourself and knowing and showing that we can have an election in Baltimore that is not one that drags people through the mud, that focuses on the issues that we have, and I look forward to working with each and every one of you caring Baltimoreans on how we can move the city together. To my good friend Mayor Young, I want everybody in Baltimore to join me for thanking the mayor who took over city government amidst another corruption scandal, who immediately faced the issues around the cyber attack in Baltimore, who had to deal with the continuing gun violence epidemic and now a global health pandemic. His service to the city of Baltimore during this trying time has been very admirable, and we owe him a debt of gratitude, because we know Mayor Young each and every day wakes up, eats, sleeps, breathes, and thanks Baltimore, and we should be for eternally grateful for him, for his efforts. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We will always love and appreciate you, and you will always be someone that the citizens of Baltimore will always remember. Let me also say this. Our campaign for a new way forward. Hold on 1 second, everybody. Our campaign showing a new way forward for Baltimore, we want this to be an example. I want this to be an example to each and every young person in the city of Baltimore. We can do whatever we say we want to do. The impossible is possible for us. Don't let anyone tell you that your zip code, that your neighborhood, that your city is going to determine how high you can go. You can go as high as you want to, young people. I'm an example of it. I want you, each and every one of you, to be a greater example of it. Let this race remind you to always shoot your shot, to always chase your dreams, because you can achieve them. As your mayor, I will strive each and every day to remind you of your worth and seek out your contributions, because you ultimately will be the generation that makes Baltimore the best Baltimore we can be. To Baltimore, this isn't over, this is just the beginning. We can and will build a better Baltimore, but it's gonna take something. It's gonna take us coming together to do the work of building a new city from top to bottom, inside and out. I plan to work with everyone in this city who dedicates themselves to Baltimore. Let's unite and move Baltimore forward. That's the only way and only place that we have to go. Baltimore, we cannot afford to have any division at this critical point in our history. To make it out of this deep parching and this deep hole that we have been in for quite some time, we have to come together. That's the only way we're gonna make it out of gun violence. That's the only way that we're gonna make it past COVID-19. We can do it, and we can be stronger for it. We can turn the tide. We can make Baltimore better. We can truly be more. But to truly be more and move Baltimore forward, it's not gonna just take us to unite and come together. We all are gonna have to be willing to look each other in these cells, ourselves in the mirror, and be uncomfortable. Because going back to normal wasn't good enough for Baltimore. Going back to normal in Baltimore was leaving generations of people, neighborhoods behind, families behind, and that's not the Baltimore that we're trying to build. A new way forward is about doing what's best for Baltimore, even when it's uncomfortable, even when it means that we have to deal with less, even it means when we have to put aside our personal feelings, visions, and ways that we see the world to do the greater good. For now, I will continue to serve as your city council president with the intensity that I always have, but I look forward to representing each and every person in Baltimore City. Even those who did not vote for me, I want you to be comfortable in knowing that I'm going to be your. I'm going to reach out to you, because Baltimore will only truly be more when we all do more and we all come together to realize that we truly are the greatest city in America. Thank you. Woo! Paul?
Have you spoken with Mayor Young yet about any particular transition? And if not, when do you plan on having that conversation?
No, Mayor Young and I will be having those conversations, but I spoke to him this morning, as everyone saw on the board of estimates, and I look forward to speaking to him again.
Secondly, you're 36 years old. You got a young council coming up. This council looks vastly different than it did during the 2015 unrest. What message does that send, and how eager are you to work with them on trying to move the city forward, as you said?
I'm very eager. It says that it's time. We talked a lot, Paul, about transformational and generational change leadership. And when you look back to 2011, when I was elected in at 27, we can see now that the city has progressed. We had 2016, we went to having 9 members on the council out of 15 under 40. This is, I think, is going to be a great thing for Baltimore. It's our time. It's our time to stand on the shoulders of those who came before us, realizing, recognizing the great work that was done and fixing the things that were broken. So I look forward to working with every member of the council in a way that no mayor has before.
Can you tell us about last night when you found out what the numbers showed? What were you doing and what was that like?
I actually was working in true fashion. I was actually asking a question of DPW on the DPW's hearing, because we're discussing a budget right now. So it's very exciting, but there's a lot of work to do. I don't have time to celebrate, right? We have a lot of work to do. We still have too many people dying in Baltimore City. We still have a global health pandemic, and I have to make sure that we send a budget to the mayor for before the end of the month.
Council President, can you talk about what it's like to win the race as the greatest civil unrest of decades is happening throughout the country, and what you're that?
Well, for me, this is just a continuance, right? This is something for me, it's fitting. I've been someone who's been fighting for police reform since I've been on the council, someone who passed Baltimore's racial equity law a few years ago, because these are things that I truly believe in. And understanding that what those young people who I've been out there, you know, every single night doing those protests, what they want is deep. For us, like, hey, they know the change isn't going to happen overnight, but we can no longer way that we've been operating in our country is not working, and it has to change so that everyone is treated with the same value and respect. I said earlier that my family moved here from the rural South, right? And now I'm facing and dealing with my entire lifetime a different brand of racism than the one that they face in Virginia and North Carolina, one that's more subtle and hidden, but it's still as decimating and still as deadly. I have not.
I was going to say, the Dixon campaign is looking at their options because they aren't trusting of these numbers. Would you support a recount? Do you think there needs to be one?
I support that whatever they choose to do, right? That's up to them. I think that we all have people down at the Board of Elections. We know the issues, and I think that we all have to understand, again, that this is a mail-in ballot, right? We had more, it's just as many ballots basically to be counted on after Election Day than that was counted on Election Day. That's the reality of a mail-in election. I'm looking forward to it. I work with both of them, you know, Delegate Mosby and I came to the council together, and I've worked with Councilman Henry for a long time. So I look forward to us being able to actually do many of the things that we've talked about over the years.
Now that you're the presumed mayor, are you still in favor of changing the city charter to weaken your power?
Absolutely. It's not about me. It's about what's best for Baltimore. When we look around the country and we see how their structures are, even the structures that have strong mayors is not as strong as ours. We have to be able to, and listen, let me just say this, Paul. If I am leading the city and I can't convince members of the council to support what I'm doing, or I can't convince members of the Board of Estimates that this is the right contract, then maybe I need to look at that contract. We have to build a better structure. That was not just a campaign talking point for me. That's the reality that we face in Baltimore, because again, going back to the way that we have been operating is not an option.
You've got so much on your plate. So come November, and what the likelihood happens, what are your priorities? What is your first action?
Well, I think, listen, David, you and I talked about this the other day. I think that a lot of that depends on the transition. So you should get back to me. Depending on what we're able to accomplish now will be what we're going to be able to focus on in those first 100 days. But I am expecting and hear from Mayor Young and his team that they're willing to do a transition in a great way so that we can be able to start day one and focus on other things. Last one. Yes, sir.
What do you think about there's a move to defund police? What do you think about that?
Well, listen, I've been very clear, even last year, the beginning of our budget cycle, that we over time, as you know, I've said, over time, our police department's budget is going to have to decrease so that we can increase funding to schools and health and rec and parks and other things. We have to do that in a responsible manner. We have to do that in a way that does not ignore the fact that we, the city of Baltimore, the council of Baltimore sought out a consent decree, and that also that we still have a public safety crisis in our city, and we will begin that tough work. I asked Mayor Young to say that he and I should appoint a joint task force right now to study between now and when the new elected officials take office to see how we can responsibly do that, because the reality is that we know that we have to do it because we have to fund Kerwin, which is the most important policy thing facing the state of Maryland and Baltimore right now. Thank you, everybody.